Then I shall bow in humble adoration. Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning. Welcome to Upton Vale. I'm laughing because when that music plays, people that are doing anything up the front suddenly get a bit frantic and, oh, we need to get in the right place. But we made it. We're all here. If you're just joining us, come on in, grab a seat. Isn't it great to see the sun, everybody? It's so good, isn't it? It is wonderful. Praise Jesus for a bit of sun. I've been able to hang the washing out on the line. It's the simple things that we've got to praise God for, isn't it, sometimes? This week, we've had loads going on that we can also praise God for. We had the start of the new CAP Money course, which happened on Wednesday, which was great. Some people we've never met before came along to that, which is super. On Thursday, we had Alpha that launched as well, and there were 30 people that were on the Alpha course on Thursday. So, yeah, please be praying for the team as they journey with those people through that. And then yesterday, one of our church family, Colin, who some of you will know, he was ordained and inducted over at Brixham Baptist Church. So this is a photo of Colin. Yesterday, the sun was shining. It was absolutely glorious. And it was a real privilege and just so good to see so many people from UV there yesterday as Colin starts this new journey in his ministry. There he is, looking proud as punch. And it was really, really good. So please be praying for him and for Jill as they go where God leads them. And that leads me nicely into our first block of worship, because the song that we're going to start with this morning is Oceans. I didn't choose the songs, David chose the songs. And when I saw that Oceans was the first one, I was really moved, because at my ordination 8 years ago, the song that I chose after I'd said those promises was Oceans. And so I always get a bit emotional when we sing it, because it's really, yeah, it just resonates with me. And I don't remember singing it. I think I just cried my way through it. But it is just a really, yeah, poignant song. And if you know the song and what it's based on, we have the disciples out in the boat and Jesus is away on the mountainsides. And it's a bit stormy out at sea, so not like the sea today, which is looking sparkly and wonderful, as they're sat in a boat in the storm. And Jesus appears on the water, and Peter says, "If it's you, Lord, tell me to come, and I will step out of the boat onto the water." And Jesus says, "Come," and Peter stepped out of the boat, and he walked on the water towards Jesus. We know that he had a bit of fear, and he started to sink, but Jesus caught his hand and led him back to safety in the boat. And so I wonder this morning, what might God be calling you to do? Is there a place in your life where God is calling you to step out of your boat, of the safety that you're in? Maybe you need God's help and encouragement this morning to not be afraid. Maybe the fear is the thing that is kind of keeping you from stepping out. Well, I want to invite us all this morning, as Jesus said, come to Peter, for us all to come to Jesus. And let's not wait until the prayers or until the sermon. Let's start right now. We've got a block of three songs. So let's just really step out and come towards God. So why don't we stand together and I will pray, and then we'll hand over to the band to lead us. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much that you are here by your Spirit this morning. And God, we thank you that you are a God who is true and a God who is faithful. And so I pray, Lord, that where there are things in our lives where we need to step out of the boat, to put our trust in you, God, would you wipe away the fear, the anxiety, and give us a sense of your peace. Give us your courage to trust you, to be led by your Spirit. Take us deeper than our feet could ever wander, knowing that we don't do it alone, but we do it with the God who formed creation with just one word. So we gather together to worship you and to praise you, for you are good. Amen.
Thank you. There's a passage I was looking at in the book of Luke, and it's the passage after Jesus has been condemned and crucified and buried, and two of his disciples are walking away. They've turned their back on the promises. They've turned their back on the plans that they thought were going to happen. Their world seems to be falling apart. They're broken and empty. And somebody walks alongside them and explains the scriptures. And it's only looking back that they can see that it was Jesus with them. And in Luke it says, stunned, they looked at each other and said, why didn't we recognize him? Didn't our hearts burn with the flames of holy passion? So we're going to sing a song now asking God to open our eyes, but to make our hearts burn with those flames of holy passion. This is consuming fire. With us this morning. Open our ears to the word of your leading. Fill us anew with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Lord, there are those here today who are feeling empty, those of us who are feeling broken. Lord, fill us with your Spirit, fill us anew, fill us until we are overflowing. And help us to understand, Lord, that the cracks in our lives can be the channels of your grace, and that when our plans don't come to fruition, those are the times when your plans can triumph. Amen.
Amen. Do take a seat. So we've got a couple of information items before the children, youth, and B2 head out. One of them is that the church meeting is on Tuesday the 30th of April, so a week on Tuesday, and it's at 7:30, not 7 p.m, 7:30. And the other information item, Rachel is going to come and share. Because you may have followed a bus recently, and on the back it might have had two words that say, try praying. And if you were here last week, you might know a bit about that. But if you weren't, then Rachel, you're going to fill us in and then we can show the video.
Okay, we're going to do it that way around.
Or we can do the other way around.
Let's do the video. Is that all right? Thank you very much.
Try Praying is a prayer guide with a difference. It's 7 days of prayer for people who don't see themselves as religious and who don't go to church. Try Praying has become a community event with a logo displayed on churches and local buses. It's simple to get involved. Read the Try Praying booklet yourself, thinking and praying about who to give it to. Then give it away. That's it. Use it and lose it.
If you're there, and I'm not sure you are, but if you are, I want to know you. I don't want to fool myself. I really want to know you.
Try praying. Let's start a conversation.
So, as you might remember from last week, we were talking about Try Praying, and maybe this week you've seen some buses with the banner at the back. We've got our banner out now at the front of the church, and there'll be other churches in the bay with the banner coming out this week. And basically, as we've just seen, it's all about using it and losing it. It's a national project. That's been seeing great impact already in churches across the world, and closer to home in North Devon, I know they've used it for the last couple of years and seen an amazing impact. And you may have already experienced, like we have, that very often people, if you ask them if you can pray for them, they'll very, very often say yes rather than no. And so don't be shy. Use the booklet this week. We'll all be given one as we go out of the service this morning, whether it's this one for us here, or whether there's some children's ones and some youth ones, slightly different but the same principle. So use it this week, just each day, spend a bit of time and asking the Lord at the same time, who can I share this with, ready to use it, to give it away next week. So a bit like the same principle of where we're blessed to be a blessing, and so let's use it and then lose it next week, and be surprised at what God can do and how he can use this small booklet to impact not only our own lives but those around us, friends and family. So yeah, don't be shy, and just ask the Lord, what can he do with that? And I read it this morning about how God transforms lives, and so often that is through prayer, isn't it? So use it and lose it.
Super. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you. And talking of prayer, we're going to pray now. Normally, Keris, what would I pray at this point? Would I normally pray for?
Pray for the children.
Yeah, so normally the leader at the front would pray for the children, but what are you going to do now?
Pray for the children.
Yeah, we're going to pray for the children. Ready?
Dear Father God, thank you that we can be here today in church. Please be with the adults as they listen to your word. We pray that you speak to them and they hear you. We pray for Carl as he gives today's message, and that people are ready to hear what you have to say. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So today, Keris has prayed for all you adults that are staying in, not because you've got a car, because car's great, but because we always pray for the children, youth and B2 as they leave. So if you are a child or a young person or one of the leaders or part of B2, now is the time to head to your groups. If you're new, not sure where to go, try and have a chat with someone in a little lanyard and they'll be able to help you. Wonderful. Well, while they're heading out and coming back, it feels like a mass exodus, doesn't it, at this point? Don't take it personally. Some of them will be coming back later. But Carl, for those of you that don't know who you are, can you give us a brief intro? Who are you?
Brilliant. Thank you very much. By the way, I love it when there's a mass exodus. How good is that when there's so many children and young people in the church that it feels like a mass exodus when you do that? Brilliant. My name's Carl Smethurst, and I am one of the regional ministers for the Southwest Baptist Association, and it has been a huge privilege over the last couple of years to also be your moderator, which is someone who accompanies the church through a period where there is a pastoral vacancy. You've not been without a very good minister for these last couple of years, but yes, I saw a clap. So I'm not quite sure there's been a vacancy so much, except that there are particular roles that have not been filled. That's maybe a more and better description. I spoke with Simon, who is your new minister, who you've called to be your new minister this last week, and he and the family are so excited to come and join you and to be with you. My particular role in the Southwest, though, is to talk about mission, and I love all things to do with God's mission. And so that's partly what I'm doing today, is talking a little bit about mission and home mission, I think.
Super. So because you just mentioned being a moderator for us, we've got a little just thank you for all that you've done, because probably the next time that we'll see you will be at Simon's induction service, but we thought we would do it today. So that's from UV, from us all, it's just a massive thank you for the way that you've journeyed with us, supported us, guided us, advised us, and prayed for us over this last 18 months or so. So can we just give Carl a thank you?
Brilliant, thank you.
So you don't know what's in it, though, do you? Like...
Do you want to open it now?
No, you don't need to open it now, because they want to be sharing in it, and you don't want to share it with them. So you mentioned mission briefly, and it's particularly home mission, isn't it, that you're passionate about. Can you let us know what is home mission, and then introduce, I think, a story that we're going to hear?
Yeah, I will. So home mission is how we relate to each other as Baptist churches across the Baptist Union of Great Britain. And we do that, first and foremost, by praying for others in other places that are part of God's mission. In the Southwest, we've got a good number of people who are home mission supported. I'll get to what that means in a second. But first and foremost, it would be wonderful if we could be praying for these folks around the Southwest who are part of our Southwest Baptist Association family, who are doing some incredible things for the mission of God. In the Southwest, from Penzance and Porthleven and Mevagissey through to Ilfracombe and Axminster and Exmouth, and there's a leaflet, and at the back you'll see them. They're on the table on your way out in the foyer area. Do pick one up and take it home. Inside you'll see a whole list of those who are home mission supported ministers and projects at the moment, each with a little video. We're going to watch one in just a second. You know, there are so many stories to tell, and I'm not going to take too much time, I promise you, this morning, but can I share maybe just two? Partly because it helps to illustrate what Rachel's just been talking about with try praying, the first one. Part of my role is to travel around churches, and it's a privilege to do that in the Southwest. So I'm at a different church most Sundays. And a couple of months back, I was at a church, and a gentleman, probably in his 40s, I would say, came up to me at the end of the service. And we were chatting, and I didn't recognise him from the previous time I'd been at the church. So I said, how did you find the church? Standard question. And so he said, I'd been going through a really rough time. I'd had a relationship breakdown. I wasn't seeing my kids. I wasn't happy in my job. And I cried out to God, and I said, God, if you're there, show me a sign. It was pretty much exactly what was on the screen. And then he said, and then that night I had a dream of John the Baptist. He said, I've never really been to church. I'm not quite sure where that came from. He said, I think it might have been school or something. John the Baptist came into my dream. And so the next morning I thought, I think that I walked past the Baptist church on my way to work. So he came on the Sunday. And he discovered that actually there's a God, Jesus, who loves him, who gave himself for him. And he came to faith and he's part of the church. That was how it started. It was literally just a, if there is a God, show me. And this random character from Scripture just flashed into his head. Let's pray that's happening some more. And then another story. So another one of our churches where there was a couple that I'd seen previously. Turned out the previous time I'd seen them, which had been about 18 months before, it was their first Sunday in the church. And 18 months later, I'd been back to the church again. And they said, we'd come here because we were looking for some people to help us with our little ones. They had 18 months previously, a baby in arms and a tiny, tiny tot. And so we'd seen that there were some lovely people that came to this church. So we came along. They were looking for grandparent-type people, I think. And we settled in the church. And he said, anyway, over the last 18 months, we feel that God's really spoken to us. We've done an Alpha course. We became Christians. We've been baptised. And next week, we're getting married, they said. And this is out of the blue, right? They walked into a church. Friends, God is doing some incredible things. There are people walking past the moment, this building, and having thoughts, I wonder what's going on in there, feeling a sense of being drawn. This is not an excuse for us not to speak out and to share our faith with people, by the way. But God is doing some incredible things amongst us, and they're just a couple of stories. You're about to watch a very short video now, and this is one of our home mission supported churches. When I talk about home mission supported, you give a percentage of your annual income to the home mission fund, and that fund helps to both service you as a church in terms of legal advice and pastoral care from regional and national teams and safeguarding and lots of other things. But at least half, in fact more than half in the Southwest, of everything that we get in terms of home mission gifts gets given out in grants to individuals across our patch. You're about to see Sam, who's now been in an estate, Littleham in Exmouth, for almost a decade. As a pioneer in that place. Well, he'll tell you about the latest thing that's happening, but a church has grown, people new to faith. Their baptistry is the sea. And so they've baptised people and the church is growing, primarily of folks who are very working class, who live on the estate, who are no errs and the graces kind of people. I love them being there. So things like Forest Church and Church on the Beach, it's all very outdoorsy, their style of church normally. He'll introduce to you just some new project that's about to start or just has started. So if you can watch the video, that'd be great.
Good morning, it's Sam here from The Wave. I'm super excited to be able to share a home mission update with you guys. I'm here setting up our community cafe this morning, but it's such a gorgeous day. I wanted to show you something even more exciting outside. We had a team of 45 women come and volunteer to build us a community garden in one day. And the outcome is astounding. So I'm going to take you for a little tour around that right now so you can see what's been going on and I can tell you a little bit more about our plans for our community garden. Thank you. So what we're super excited about with the community garden is that it gives us a space to be able to grow food with our community, to spend time in the garden, to engage with those around, get out into the beautiful outdoors and allow people a space to relax, to spend time, to get to know others. It's a really, really exciting opportunity. And the beautiful thing is, what this does is this means we can grow food here. We can then take that food into our community cafe and use the food to serve the community. We can cook meals together and sit in this beautiful outdoor seating and eat the food together. And we can fill our community fridge with the food as well. This goes so much more than just growing food. It's about supporting our entire community. One of the key things we've seen as we've journeyed with this community over the last 8 years is that actually, yes, people want to know about Jesus, but then the question comes up, yeah, but how can you tell me there's a God who loves me when I can't even feed my family? And so what we've learned is that if we can meet people's physical need, then it gives us an opportunity to explore with them their spiritual needs. My prayer for this garden is that yes, we will nurture these seeds and these plants and grow food together, and that will be amazing. But more than that, my prayer for this garden is that we will nurture seeds of faith. So thank you so much for supporting Home Mission. We would not be able to do this kind of stuff if we didn't have the support of you guys. So thank you. Please do give to Home Mission. It makes a massive difference to our community.
Amazing. So that is Sam over in Exmouth. If you want to go and visit him, I know that he'd be delighted to have any support or some help. So yeah, let me know because I've got his contact details. And tonight our prayer meeting, we'll be praying for Home Mission. We've got Charlie who's down in Megavissey. I think some of you went down to visit Charlie when they first went down in Megavissey. So he's going to be joining us. And we've also got Isabella who's the young adults team leader for the Baptist Union. She'll be sharing with us as well, so come along at 7 o'clock this evening on Zoom. Now I'm going to hand over to Mary, who's going to pray, and Margie, who's going to read, and then Carl, over to you.
Good morning. Shall we pray? Oh Lord, we've heard so much already, so much that we can praise you for, and we do. Thank you, Lord, for the areas that you're working in, the areas of the church, and we give you our thanks. We give you our thanks that the emphasis is on prayer, and you say, call to me. We haven't got to have special words, but simply come and talk. And that's what we want to do this morning, just talk to you. Lord, there are many things that we can thank you for, but there are also other anxieties. And sometimes those anxieties crowd in so that we can't think of all the blessings that we have. And we pray for our world. Lord, for all the areas that are at war in so many places. We pray for those leaders. Oh Lord, that they would negotiate for peace and not for power. We pray for our own country as we face elections soon. Thank you that we have Christian politicians. And we pray for real wisdom as we take part in voting. And we say, let your will be done. Lord, there's things going on in this town and we're so thankful for them. We pray for Alpha starting again. Lord, use those days, those evenings. Use them. And we pray for those that are there. And we know that there are people there who don't know you yet. And we ask that your spirit may move so strongly in this place. Those people would be moved to call on your name. And the other things that are going on, led by your church, the CAP, those that look after homeless people, the street pastors, all these things don't work on their own. They need people. So we pray for all these different things that go on, that there will be sufficient Christians to lead them, support those that are involved already. Lord, we long to see revival. And as we sit here, we know that those who are struggling with different things, struggling with loss, we particularly pray for Matt and the family, and the loss of his mum. We continue to pray for Celia. These things don't just go away. Help us to be sensitive to those around us. And today, we pray for Carl as he brings his message. Open our ears that we will hear your word to us. And as we go out from here, Lord, help us to take in the beauty of your creation all around us. Not just walking with eyes straight forward and straight in front, but listening to the bird song, listening and seeing the beauty that you've created. Lord God, if there's someone we should meet to share something with you, help us to be on the right side of the footpath. We ask it in your name. Amen.
This morning, as we continue going through the books of the Old Testament, we reach the book of Zephaniah, and we're reading from chapter 3, beginning at verse 14. Sing, daughter Zion. Shout aloud, Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all your heart, daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away your punishment. He has turned back your enemy. The Lord, the King of Israel, is with you. Never again will you fear any harm. On that day, they will say to Jerusalem, do not fear, Zion. Do not let your hands hang limp. The Lord your God is with you. The mighty warrior who saves, he will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. I will remove from you all who mourn over the loss of your appointed festivals, which is a burden and reproach for you. At that time, I will deal with all who oppressed you. I will rescue the lame. I will gather the exiles. I will give them praise and honor in every land where they have suffered shame. At that time, I will gather you. At that time, I will bring you home. I will give you honor and praise among all the people of the earth. When I restore your fortune before your very eyes, says the Lord.
Thank you so much. Thank you for that gift as well, which is very unexpected. It is genuinely a privilege to serve you, and it has been a wonder and a joy over the last 2 years to see how God, who we know is faithful, has been faithful to us as a family here in this place. It's been wonderful to see people step out of the boat and explore and exercise new gifts, and I want to encourage that more and more and more amongst us. Please, let's continue to be God's body here on earth, each with a part and a role to play. And I want to bring you greetings from across the association family and from our team, from Nigel, who I think you heard last Sunday. Regional ministers like the buses. Never show up, and then you get two at the same time. But no, anytime we are welcome. We certainly would welcome invitation to come and spend time with you at any point in time. But also from our extended team, some of you will have met Glenda Chadwick Down, who's our Children, Youth, and Families Mission Enabler, and Charlie. Please do come to the prayer meeting tonight for mission. Please come. It's, I think, on Zoom, is that right? So Zoom in and hear from Charlie. So he's pioneering in Mevagissey, but he's also our comms officer. And from James, who is our learning community coordinator, and who's doing so many wonderful things to encourage us to learn more about God. And he'd skin me if he heard I hadn't shown you this. There are some of these leaflets as well at the back. Please take them. If any of you are interested in either some occasional learning on subjects like biblical studies or doctrine or practical things like pastoral care or communicating God's word or evangelism and mission or how we engage in our faith in contemporary culture. These are all Saturday teaching modules, which are taught in Exeter, but you can also join on Zoom if you wish. And if you are feeling a sense of exploring God's call to ministry, which could be of a local church, or it could be chaplaincy, or pioneering, it could be as an evangelist, then please grab a leaflet and have a read. But what you saw yesterday was Colin's induction as someone who was called to ministry in a local church alongside another minister, and he went through this training. This is the training he did. So these occasional learning and recognised local ministry programmes, you'll find out about them in that leaflet. I'm so delighted that you have spent the time over this last year or so considering the Old Testament, but seeing how it points to Jesus. How in the arc of Scripture, we've got this wonderful, wonderful sense of all that points to the central character of Jesus Christ. And then of how all things radiate from Jesus forwards as well. It's wonderful to place these books in the Old Testament in that big arc of Scripture. And I'm excited by this book today. Now, if you've read Zephaniah, as some of you will, it's only kind of three chapters. It wouldn't take you very long to read. Excitement might not be the first word that comes to mind when you read particularly the first couple of chapters. It seems pretty heavy going. And in fact, actually, there's no disguising the fact it is heavy going. Zephaniah is, I think, probably amongst the minor prophets, someone who sits within the temple, within the royal courts, someone in the line of Hezekiah with a royal kind of heritage, someone of some influence, but someone that speaks God's word, this prophetic word, so powerfully and with such honesty that it really stings. But as with nearly all of the prophets that we read in the Old Testament, alongside the warnings and the judgments, and we must consider that this morning, there is hope. And I want us to hold on to that. That passage so beautifully read for us this morning, thank you, is the final part of this book. And what it reveals is a God of hope, who rescues us, a God who saves us, a God who is with us in all things, and a God who ultimately will gather us home. Let's keep hold of the hope whilst hearing of the judgment at the same time. Zephaniah writes in a time of transition in the nation of Judah, and we've got a new king, Josiah, that is on the throne, a king who will attempt to reform the nation who's turned their back on God and point them back to Yahweh again. A king who's a good king. At this point of this prophecy, he's early in power, about 600, 650 years before Jesus. And this prophecy would mean a huge amount to the people who heard it, but I think means a huge amount to us today. And what I'd love us to do as we consider briefly this book, The Judgment and the Hope, is to consider how that would have been taken in its original context, but also to consider how that might be taken by us today. What are the importance of these words to you and to I here in the present? And how might we learn from those that have gone before us? Next slide, please. The judgment that we hear is incredibly, incredibly cutting. There's no holding back in Zephaniah's words here. Here we read just at the very beginning of the book, and he says of God speaking to his people, "I will utterly sweep away everything from the face of the earth," says the Lord. "I'll sweep away humans and animals. I will sweep away the birds of the air and the fish of the sea. I'll make the wicked stumble. I'll cut off humanity from the face of the earth," says the Lord. Well, before you just think Zephaniah got out of the wrong side of bed that morning, actually, these are incredibly powerful words to a nation that has turned its back on its God. A nation who, despite the relationship that Yahweh wants with them, has decided that they don't want that relationship, has turned to other idols, to false gods. Zephaniah goes on to talk about a great day of the Lord, a day of judgment. "The great day of the Lord is near," he writes, "near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. A day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements." This is bleak stuff. But to those people at that time, they hear the word of a jealous God. A God who wants to be central in their life. A God who demands them to worship no other but him, the one true God. A God who will not compromise on that. A God who actually, if they look at their past, will see is a God of love who has their best at heart. A God who wants to lead them into all truth and knowledge, but that's the God that they have turned their back on. They hear of this future coming judgment. Friends, they will experience some of that in some ways. The powerful nation of Assyria, as it begins to weaken, is replaced quickly by the hugely destructive forces of the Babylonians. God's people will be scattered. God's holy place will be laid to ruin. God's people will be exiles for a period of time, and these words will stay with them. Remember, There is hope. There is hope for them. That's not the end of this prophecy. But when we think about what this might mean for us, it makes us face some harsh realities for ourselves as well. You see, maybe we can think about our nation turning its back on God, and we can think about actually how as a nation we need to turn back to God again. We can hear these words of judgment on us in all kinds of different, if you like, corporate ways. But I, as an individual, before the God who has my best in heart, must face the fact that sometimes God is not central in my life. That for me, I sometimes turn my back on others. For me, there'll be other idols that are more important than the one true God, who is jealous for me, who loves me with a passion, and who hates to see me turn my back on him and to make other things more important. Friends, there is hope. We're about to hear of it. But let's face reality for ourselves. Are there more important things in our lives than the one true God, who loves us with a passion, a jealous love? Have we turned our back on the one who wants to be central in our lives, who wants to lead us into all truth and all hope for our future? If you are human, if you have tried to follow Jesus, unless you've achieved full sanctification, and I won't ask for a show of hands on that one, then actually, you and I stand together. And let's this day recognize if that is what God is saying to us. You've put something else in my place. Something's more important. Your career, your family, finance. You've made a god of your health. Dare I say, friends, the church is more important than the worship of the one true God. If that is the case, well, let's start by acknowledging that. But please, there is hope. There is hope for you and for I, for God's people scattered as exiles. There is hope. There was hope. Let us hear of that hope. Next slide, please. Chapter 3. On that day, you shall not be put to shame, because of all the deeds by which you've rebelled against me, says the Lord. For then I will remove from your midst your proudly exultant ones, and you shall no longer be haughty in my holy mountain. For I will leave in the midst of you a people humble and lowly. They shall seek refuge in the name of the Lord, the remnant of Israel. They shall do no wrong and utter no lies, nor shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouths. Then they will pasture and lie down, and no one will be afraid of them. On that day of the Lord, on that judgment day, there is hope for those who choose to follow God, the remnant, those that are left, there is hope. You will not be put to shame. And then those beautiful words that we just heard read to us. Sing, daughter Zion. Shout aloud, Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all of your heart, daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away your punishment. He has turned back your enemy. The Lord, the King of Israel, is with you. Never again will you fear any harm. On that day, they will say to Jerusalem, do not fear, Zion. Do not let your hands hang limp. The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love, and he will rejoice over you with singing. You see, for you, for me, for those of us that recognize that other things have taken a priority in our lives rather than the one true God who loves us, there is hope in the God who saves. The people who first would have heard these words in exile shortly afterwards would have held on to these words with all of their might. They will have seen that this God had not entirely rejected them. They'll experience being brought back from exile again. These are words that root us in God and in the hope that can be only found in him. But as I read some of those words, did you also hear them for yourself today in the light of Jesus? Did you understand and read those words as to the difference that it makes to us in these days as well? That we will find a saviour. That the Lord has taken away our punishments. That God has turned back our enemies. That God delights in us. These are words for you and for me. Because as we read the sweep of Scripture, we recognize that ultimately God's salvation comes not through might or power, through armies or through violence. It comes through his Son, Jesus Christ, who was given for us, who took the punishment for our sin. We stand as those that are free from that burden. Before God, who loves justice, the price for our freedom has been paid. More than that, you see, the sin that we have known not only has been taken from us, we're not just free from sin, but it's been exchanged for God's righteousness. We don't just live as those free from that which has held us past. We live as those clothed with the righteousness of God. Is anyone a little bit excited by that? Brilliant. I can see it breaking forth on some faces. That's good news. This is our hope. This is the hope for Torbay. This is the hope for the whole world, that we don't live under judgment, that because of Jesus, we are free from that judgment. Next slide, please. And just one more move on, please. Thank you. You might well have heard, and maybe even here, you'll have sessions of worship that we talk about soaking. It's a contemporary phrase for some. We soak in worship together. Well, I'd encourage us to soak in Scripture together, in God's Word given to us, not just as an academic exercise to read and to study, though I think that that is important, but as the Word of life that nourishes our soul. This is God's Word. This is Scripture. And I'd love us, just for a few moments, and before we come towards a close, to soak in this one verse. I'm going to help us to consider how these words, written over 600 years before Jesus, find their fulfillment in our Savior Jesus Christ. They could have been written, you see, as much by the Apostle Paul in the New Testament as by Zephaniah in the Old Testament. They, I pray, are our experience today. The Lord is with you. The Lord is with you. The Word became flesh. and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Lord is with you. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, surely I am with you always, always, to the very ends of the age. This, friends, is not a distant God. This is not a God made of wood and idol. This is the true and living God, not far from, but with you. This day, receive it. As you look to this week, with its turmoils and its troubles, receive it. As you consider an uncertain future, receive this word from Scripture today. The Lord is with you. He is mighty to save. 1 John 4. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Saviour of the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son in the world to condemn the world, but in order that, does anyone know the last bit? The world might be saved. He is mighty to save. And he who is mighty to save is Jesus, the Son of God sent into the world to take upon himself the sins of the world, so that you could know that burden lifted, so that you could know not just that burden lifted, but the righteousness of God clothed in his righteousness in its place. He's mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. Peace I leave with you, it says in John 14, the words of Jesus. My peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. He'll quiet you with his love. In some translations, it says he will renew you with his love. I love that God renews us with his love. But do you know what? In a noisy and chaotic world, I think I want to stick with he will quiet you. Right? What a beautiful image. That in the chaos and the voices that shout constantly at us, that the love of God made known in Jesus quietens us, brings peace, even where that might seem it can't happen, in the midst of despair, in the midst of grief, in the midst of uncertainty, we can know God quietening us and, yes, renewing us with his love. And he will rejoice over you with singing. Luke 15. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Some words as Jesus shares, of course, the parable of the lost sheep. Rejoicing over you in heaven. Hold that for a second. A couple of us earlier were talking a little bit about our sung worship. We're talking about how God ministers to us in all kinds of different ways. But can you glimpse a little picture, just for a second, of that? The rejoicing over the one who is saved, over each of us in heaven, all of heaven singing. the angels rejoicing, that expansive, can't get your head around celebration, party that heaven breaks forth with all who repent. We read that verse, and it particularly is poignant when this baptistry is open. And I'm praying for the day that there's no point in you emptying it, by the way. Or there's no reason to put the lid back on, because it's being used. Not every Sunday, why not daily, yeah? Well, this is what God's doing, I believe, amongst us. So let's be expectant for that. That's great that this verse is used in those occasions, but I want you to hear this for yourself today. Whether you're new to faith or whether you've walked with Jesus for 40 years, I want you to hear this for yourself today, that the Lord rejoices over you. He rejoices over each of you with singing. All of heaven rejoices over all those who are saved. If you are one who walks with Jesus today, then heaven rejoices over you. If you want a verse to soak in this week, then I suggest you crack open that one from Zephaniah chapter 3 and verse 17 and allow the Spirit of God to minister to your soul. If you want to study it, brilliant. For those of you that read Hebrew, how wonderful. We'll look at the various translations of that particular verse. But please allow it to speak to your soul. And as we come into land, next slide, please. There's one other verse that I think, you see, offers us hope, not just in the present, but it offers us hope for the future as well. Because with so much of this prophecy of the Old Testament, it meant something to the people of the time. It means something to us in the light of Jesus now, but it also means something to us and those beyond us for the future, for a future hope. I will remove from you all who mourn over the loss of your appointed festivals, which is a burden and reproach for you. This is chapter 3. At the end, I will deal with all who oppressed you. I will rescue the lame. I will gather the exiles, says the Lord. I will give them praise and honor in every land where they have suffered shame. And at that time, I will gather you. At that time, I will bring you home. Now, if they're not word of hope to exiles in a far-flung land, I don't know what are. But if they're not words of hope to us today, for our sure and certain hope with Jesus, I don't know what are. You see, as I read those words, I think of those who I'll be gathered home with. An eternal home with Jesus. I think of those who have gone before me, who've spoken into my life. I think of the chap who was called Uncle Doug, who was my Sunday school teacher. I'd like a chat with Uncle Doug again. One day, maybe I'll be able to. And I think of those closer to me, my own father, who spoke so much wisdom into my life and demonstrated what it means to be a person of God in the world today. I think of those who are not with us, and there is such hope and such comfort in the knowledge that I think, I know, that those words are for us today. At that time, I'll gather you. At that time, I will bring you home. It's not just for this day, it's for an eternal future that we read these words. It's because of Jesus that we can have this confidence. And it's because of him that even though we acknowledge the judgment of God, we live in the hope that God brings. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. So that what? So that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. As we leave this place, May it be with that sense of overflowing hope to the world around us that we have found in Jesus, recognizing God's judgment, but living in God's hope. I'm going to sing again in a second, but can I pray for us? Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that this is life and light for us. Father, I pray that this day, as we hear your word, we recognize you as a God of justice. You demand justice, but Lord, we thank you that, Lord, we don't stand subject to your judgment because Jesus, you took that for us. Today we live in freedom and hope. Today we live in the confidence of knowing an eternity with you because of you, Jesus, because of you. I pray that this day, as family in this place, as individuals before you, our God, we recognize you to be the mighty Savior and the one who sings over us and delights in us this day. Hear our prayer. Amen. Amen.
Would you stand as you're able?
those who are feeling that today there are things that maybe have taken greater priority in your life than the one true living God, then don't leave the place with that being the situation. Bring that before God, put Him central again, confess those things before God. And maybe for those who are feeling that they're downtrodden, that they're facing concern and worry for the future, uncertainty, well, please, friends, don't leave this place with that burden. Let's share that and let's pray together. That, or those, I think, with purple lanyards who are in the ministry team, they're scattered around the building. Feel free to grab one of those folks or someone that you came to church with this morning and pray together, just as we're singing. Allow us to sing over you whilst you're praying. But please bring before God those things that are on your heart, that maybe the Spirit has nudged you and prompted you this morning with, and recognise that God of forgiveness is mighty to save, and that His great love for us causes Him delight, and that He sings over us this day. Let's sing together, worship together, and please pray and gather and pray with each other if that is helpful to you today.
Darkness.
Amen. Well, do hang around, stay for tea, coffee and biscuits. If you'd like prayer, please do find someone to pray with. If you can't find someone, come to the front and we'd love to pray for you. I'm going to finish with the words of the Great Commission because the kids were looking at it in their groups today and Carl mentioned it, so it just feels right to say these words over us. So therefore, may we go and make disciples of all nations this week, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching these new disciples to obey all the commands I, Jesus, have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Amen. Have a great week and we'll see you soon.